you're playing as Axemen, you have to be really sweating out how long you spend fighting the other guy. Or if you're against Axemen, you have to shut down those engines or, you know, strap in for a deep round.
All right, so before we go into the match, Radovid versus Axemen, who you got real quick?
I got Radovid. You're going to shut down two of their engines, and, you know, you've got the potential of Radovid to have armor as well, shutting down, you know, some of the damage that's going to happen. And with the engines down too, oof, I'd hate to see Radovid as Axemen.
All right, straight to the action we go.
Okay, so we get into our first game, and of course we have Itchiko on blue. We see him with his kind of alchemy Nilfgaard style list, and right already we see Jgro on the Axemen.
Yeah, so we are going to get to see this Axemen deck in action. I do believe that the Golden Weathers are going to be particularly good here, as Alchemy is a deck that really, by nature, has to play into all three rows.
Yep, that's absolutely right. We'll have to see exactly how this goes here. It looks like there might have been a slight issue with the names, though, because this should be Ichiko's Axemen list and Jgro's Alchemy list.
Yeah, so we're just going to move on from that and work on the matchup here. We've got the Alchemy player that's going to be making the first play here, and I expect to see a Slave Driver.
Yep. So we're going to be starting off. We see Whale Harpooners right off the bat, of course. Classic Axemen staples. And if you weren't sure it was Axemen already just by seeing Harold, you are now. Now, it's going to come down to exactly how you want to play this out. Obviously, you have the Viper Witchers. Those are going to do great jobs at controlling the Axemen. You have the Scorch. You have the Mandrake. You have pretty much all the answers you're going to want. Do you think that might be enough to favor him in this matchup?
I think that the Alchemy deck is going to be slightly favored here, but as from the other side of the matchup, your Gold Weathers and in general your weather effects are so good. I think both decks have tools that are very effective against the other deck, so I'm interested to see how this will play out here.
That's exactly right, and while we do see a lot of effective hard removal in Ichiko's hand, he does not have any weather clears at the same time, and here's a muzzle that he can't take right now, but we know is at the second to top card of his list, which is of course a big deal against Axemen. He has no choice but to Viper Witcher his own Slave Driver, but he doesn't actually really mind that because it's effectively just Axemen fodder anyway, and it allows him to poultice in round one.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's totally fine there. That just opens up some more options. Alchemy is a deck type that really benefits from having a loaded graveyard. And here we're going to see yet another weather commitment, trying to punch the row stack. Normally you want a row stack to sort of play around Golden Weather and minimize its impact, and just immediately getting punished with the Burn a Brand here.
Yeah, that is pretty committal right off the bat. Of course, putting yourself in a vulnerable situation to clear, but you don't ever expect Alchemy Nilfgaard typically to be bringing it because they have very tight silver slots and a relatively hard time hitting in Van Hammer.
There is always the potential of hitting Van Hammer off the Runestone, and I think something like that might be enough to swing this matchup back. We don't see any way to access the Runestone currently, except, of course, if it happened to fly off of Vilgefortz.
Yep, there's the Axemen coming out, except it's going to be in the hands of the Nilfgaard. Oh, and there's the Axemen coming out from Jgro. This goes to 9 immediately outside of muzzle range, if that was even an issue. At any point, Ichiko can Mandrake it, banishing it to the Shadow Realm, or he can save up for a Scorch later as well. However, unfortunately, it's right outside of the range of his Viper Witchers. He's thinking about taking the Mandrake early, and he does. There's the immediate Mandrake. Now, what this does do is it does deny any potential for Spear Maidens coming out, although it is a little bit early at the same time.
Yeah, I find it a bit early, but I think he's just going for the knockout punch. There's the potential with a deck like Axemen that relies so heavily on just a few cards,
exactly,
particularly its namesake cards and the Darren, that he just has the potential to completely blow his opponent out if he doesn't have access to more of that type of effect. Now, as we see, the Darren is going to come down, and do you think he's regretting the use of Mandrake there a little bit?
I don't actually think so immediately. I mean, he has other ways to kill this Darren, and ultimately, you have ways of killing the Darren that don't banish it. Here's the Viper Witcher. That's going to slam this immediately, and of course, you would rather have the Axemen banished, because even though the Darren is stronger, the Axemen is much more resable, and we see no Sigdriffa in Jgro's hand. Here's the Avalak, and he has the draws. Is he going to be able to develop more Axemen?
Yeah, he's certainly digging for him, and it does not look like he has a way to find anything right now. This is probably going to cripple his ability to go super long in the round, yet as the Axemen player, you really need a decent-sized round 3. So he's sort of at an interesting crossroads here. I'm not sure how he's going to proceed. What do you think, Swim?
There's a slave driver again. Yeah, it's going to come down to whether this weather is enough to just carry Jgro through this round. On one hand, he doesn't have Axeman. On the other, though, Itchiko doesn't have Ale. That's very, very important. It's a very rare situation while not having Axeman might actually not mean you are forced out of the round. The Skilligastorm is taking 4 per turn, which of course adds up amazingly, and there's Ichiko's Axeman getting to 10 strength already.
Obviously, the Nilfgaard is the better Axeman deck here, right? This is super interesting, and this is really a test of player skill when your deck's not functioning on all cylinders, right? And you sort of got to work with not quite all the pieces you want. How can you make it work? How can you pull out rounds? How can you win games when maybe your draw isn't exactly perfect?
Exactly. And if you're Itchiko right now, you're just thinking about drawing it out as long as possible. There is an extremely aggressive Trial of the Grasses on the Viper Witcher. That's going to swing for 24 on that gold. And as we can see, Jgro has no immediate way of dealing with a super high value target like that. Without an Axeman, he cannot threaten a great amount of Herald Reach. Could be Ichigo is planning for a pass off of a tempo play like that.
Yeah, I am really liking this fast, hard, aggressive play. Both players are here to play. They are not messing around. They're pulling no punches. They are not shy to throw haymakers even very, very early in the game.
At the same time, though, it's going to be very, very, very hard to actually come back from this amount of tempo. You are losing 6 points a turn. Ichiko is going to take the pass. This will force 1 additional card out of Jgro, but without the Trial of the Grasses, he is going to be going into a round 3 where he's effectively hoping that Jgro doesn't draw the Axeman. He's also looking for Sigdriffa on Jaeger's end, which of course allows him to get that Darren back.
Yeah, 100%. That's certainly the case, and I'm really interested to see. What do you think, Swim? He got one of the Golden Weathers out already, right?
Yes.
So there's going to be this dynamic of he's going to have all these Mahakanals still in his deck that he's going to want to get value out of. Do you think he can even afford to play around the Karathi Heatwave in round 3?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
Yeah, it's going to be a pretty tight situation. We see Jgro draw the Axeman, draw the Sigdriffa for the Darren, and he looks like he's in a supremely dominant position, probably gearing up for a dry pass here. He's certainly thinking about it. If he takes it, he, of course, goes into an even ground with the last play. There's the dry pass. Ichiko has the Aesir. He can return the Darren if he wants to brick the Sigdriffa, but it gives Jgro the chance of drawing it.
Yeah, it's very interesting here. I don't think the dry pass surprised anyone, as Axeman does prefer this long round. Let's see if he goes for the Darren.
Ooh, I like this play.
He's
predicting the Sigdriffa draw. He knows the Sigdriffa wasn't there in the opening hand because Jgro didn't commit it, but at the same time, he predicted that Sigdriffa would be drawn. He blocks it out. Jgro still has the chance, 2 more draws in round 3 to find that Axeman, but even if he does, Ichigo is still holding on to the Muzzle, and he's still holding on to more potential Viper Witchers.
Yeah, so we're going to see if Muzzle's a card that's really on his radar, because it's not very common in these Alchemy-style lists. So if you guys remember back in round 1 when the Axeman came down the first one at 9 strength. That was due to the Skelligastorm. Let's see how he navigates this and if he's got Muzzle on his radar or not.
Okay, so Jgro does not draw the Darren, but it is a cursed unit, so Skell can still pull it out. And if that does happen, Ichiko might kick himself a little bit, of course, because then even if he kills it, the Sigdriffa will just bring it back. Ichiko is going to open with Vesemir on Runestone. This has an option to pull a Weatherclear. He does it before the Karathi Heatwave comes down. Jgro looks a little surprised, and Ichiko is going to pull out the Joachim Duet. This plays for a huge amount of tempo here.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised as well. Maybe he's thinking he needs to develop multiple bodies in one particular turn, but it certainly could be a little bit early on the usage there. What I'm thinking is, yeah, and like we were talking about, so it looks like he's going to be forced to play into at least 2 rows. Maybe this is sort of playing half court, you know, mitigating the damage that could be dealt by this.
Yeah, and there's the heat wave. If you are Ichiko, you're definitely feeling very unfortunate that you do not have a clear. You know, there are 7 turns left in this round. We see that there is an Axeman, there is a Sigdriffa, and most importantly, there is a Restore. It's just going to depend on whether Jgro is going to try to scale and whether the scale will hit Darren.
Yeah, it doesn't even have to directly hit the Darren, right? Because it could also hit an Udalric, which
exactly.
Isn't necessarily bad, and he gets redraws there, so I really like the positioning of the Axeman player. This is sort of, when you draw up your game plan as Axeman, this is where you want to be. Medium to long round 3, gold weather, and Axeman.
Skull hits the Darren. This gives him a second grab for it. Even if this goes down, it will likely go down to a Viper Witcher immediately. It's outside of Muzzle range. Here's the Viper Witcher. It's going to block the Drought, but the Sigdriffa will be coming down to res that Darren at any time.
Yeah, it looks like that Darren is just not long to stay in the graveyard. We're also looking at the potential for a restore here. There's just multiple ways to bring it back. I don't know that the Alchemy player is going to be able to keep it off the board for long enough for it to really matter.
Yeah, it looks like Ichiko's in a very, very tight position. Obviously, he finds himself ahead on points, but taking an Axeman into an 8 or 9 card round, not burning Herald, and still having 3 Axeman plays, more than enough counters for even the Scorch and the Muzzle to be able to outlast. We may see the Muzzle. Here's the Muzzle coming down on the 7-strength Axeman, and he's keeping a positive lead, but these last 5 turns are going to be a ridiculous amount of value for Jgro.
Yeah,
do you think that Scorch will be enough as a finisher?
I don't know. I really don't know. This game's going to be a little bit closer than I thought. That Muzzle is so good there. It's not only just the 14 points. It is so much more than 14 points here, denying a key part of his opponent's strategy. The thing is that you can generate so much value with a Herald, right?
I think this is actually going to be pretty close. Most importantly, even though Jgro has the last play to kind of effectively... You can't really dodge Scorch in this matchup, right? Jgro has the last play, but that last play kind of has to be Herald, which means that Ichiko's Scorch comes down right before the Herald, in which case there's no res that can re-res the Scorched unit before the Herald, effectively getting that value. So that actually might be pretty hard for Jgro to overcome. This could actually be a very close game in a matchup, which normally doesn't have close games.
Yeah, that's a very good point you bring up there. Let's see if the Alchemy player Ichiko is able to sequence things in the correct manner to really min-max it. You can also look at if something gets out of control. He also has the option to offensively Vilgefortz. That is going to extend the game, and it looks like he's not going for that plan.
And ultimately, I think Jgro still has a lead here. Here's the Ale. It doesn't, unfortunately, buff the Vilgefortz, so Ichiko's not going to be able to get value out of that armor immediately. It's going to be up to Jgro to decide how to do this, and this Karathi Heatwave is just ticking on full cylinders here. Here's the Sigdriffa, rezzing the Darren again, declining the restore. Darren goes to 9. Ichiko doesn't have a way to kill it immediately, but he will Scorch it later when it's bigger.
Interestingly, what if the Ale starts hitting some of these? I imagine that Darren is going to outrace some of the larger targets, but I think that's why we're not seeing...
If the Ale hits it, not necessarily at all.
Yeah, I think that's why we might have seen him decline to take the Ale there and just go with another Slave Driver.
I think that's right, yeah. So we're going to see the Harpooner come out from Ichiko off the Slave Driver. Of course, he's going to drag the Harpooner back onto Jgro's side. Now, there is a 27-point gap, but this drought is relentless. This Herald will be 16 points even if it does not buff any Darans effectively, as they are maybe killed by Scorch. I think Jgro may have this.
Yeah, relentless is exactly the right turn. It is just hitting every single turn so hard, and you're just getting the additional value off of your Darren here. We're not sure that it's going to stick to the board, but it might not even matter. As you bring up, the Herald is just a nice chunk of points by himself.
There is an Oncrete Wailer, and as you can see, even though Ichiko is playing a lot more points per turn, these 6 points off of the drought, which are effectively even higher now, it's 9 with the Darren, are just completely unanswered. And Jgro is just growing every single turn that passes. Only 2 turns left, but he only needs 8 more to close the gap.
Yeah, he's just been inching closer for the entirety of the round. That's sort of what Axeman does. It just keeps going and building and building and building, and the momentum can be really difficult to stop. A lot of times their last couple of plays are worth a large amount of points here.
Exactly. With Axeman, you really, really want to stop that snowball on round 3 because they give you such exponential value that the difference between something like 6 and 7 turns or 5 and 6 turns can absolutely make the difference of the game. Ichiko staying ahead by quite a big margin. Darren lining up for the Scorch target. Here's the restore. This will be hitting probably an Axeman. That's a Pirate Captain. The Pirate Captain will be rezzing the Demon Smuggler into the warship here. That will be buffing the Darren. Darren dies to the Scorch here. It's going to be pretty close.
It's going
to be 20 close. Point Scorch swings. The drought will tick, and it looks like Jgro does have this.
Yeah, do you ever expect the Scorch out of Alchemy there? This list, I think, was getting some value at it, just pure surprise value. It's not a commonly seen card, but as we see, the raw power, this was all about the Karathi Heatwave here. It just drained on him every single turn for a very long round, and that was inevitably enough.
Yeah, Ichiko basically making the play, hoping that there wouldn't be another weather coming down effectively off of that early pass. Generated a lot of tempo, but still falling to that one pass off of the Skellige Storm with the Ragnarok.
Yeah. It's a little tough there, and you could always look back and think, what if he had saved the option for the runestone, potentially for a weather clear? Maybe things could have turned out a little bit differently there for him. But there's also the school of thought that says, as we were talking, he probably couldn't play around the heat wave anyway. So if he has it, maybe he's so dead to it that he just has to pretend that it doesn't exist.
That's exactly right. At the same time, trying to push around one. Oh, never mind. And here's Jgro going up with Calvete versus Calvete, the alchemy mirror, I think, in this case.
Yeah, this is always a spicy matchup, and this one's going to be a little bit different than the last one we saw because of some of these off-kilter like tech choices, such as the muzzle and the scorch that aren't so commonly seen. What would you be looking to muzzle here?
There's not really any engine tools you can muzzle. Sometimes your units a lot of different things can happen in terms of strengths, like
yes,
moving up and down. You're probably not going to get more than effectively 16 points off your muzzle, but you could go for a bit of graveyard denial. It's not unthinkable that a wiper Richard could end up at 7 or 8 strength and potentially try to deny his graveyard in that way. That being said, off the slave drivers, he typically has much more than 3.
Yeah, I agree. And unless something weird happens, potentially off of a runestone or what is that, the black blood in his opponent in Jgro's hand there, I would probably snap off muzzle as soon as I saw a 16-point play with it.
Yeah, and I think Jgro ends up a bit advantaged here. He's opening with Vesemir onto Roach, a play we've seen in the past. This is a telltale sign of wanting to Aseer the Roach back into the deck, reusing that 10-point value for free later on in the game. We see the Slave Driver pulling a Forced Viper Witcher in this case. That's going to smash the Roach back down to 10, of course, because he has 10 alchemy cards.
Yeah, what do you think are the pros and cons of using the Mandrake on the Roach versus the Calvete, which seems to be the two most popular targets with these types of decks?
Well, the biggest con with the Roach is that it's counterable by something like Coral, which can banish it. In this case, it's not banished. Whereas the problem with the Calvete is that it's banishable by Mandrake. So it's really just about playing around which
sure,
banished target you're afraid of.
I completely agree. I think that's absolutely on point. So we're looking at Ichiko's hand here, and where do you think he goes? I think he would like to have another Slave Driver in his hand to potentially start getting multiple bodies on the board. You really don't want to look for a Mahakam L yet. Where do you go from here?
I'm not entirely sure. We see the Calvete coming down. He sees the Dazbog Runestone. Obviously, he's not in a position where he would want to take that Scorch yet, and I think trying to finagle value out of the Scorch might be one of the trickier things here. The Viper Witcher is going to come down. He can kill the Vesemir pretty easily here and allow himself a positioning that enables his ale later.
Yeah, I think the Scorch is going to be one of the cards to watch as this particular game plays out, because as you're saying, there's so many different ways it can not be great, but things could just line up correctly and get an absolutely massive Scorch if the Mahakam Ales decide to land on the right targets.
Yeah, exactly. And it's up to Itchiko to try to enable this muzzle value here. Now, you have a few ways of doing that. The Viper Witchers are dealing 10, for example. Here's the ale that knocks his Witcher down to 3, so if another ale hits on Jgro's side, it goes to 7. That's a somewhat acceptable muzzle target.
Yeah, I think that would be fine.
A 14-point gold isn't amazing, but you would take it in this case. It's definitely not a card that can achieve amazing value in this matchup.
The foul ale was quite good there. Talk about amazing value. Not only is it hitting for a ton of points, but it also puts Jgro in the situation where he has 2 rows without units, sort of negating some of the value he would otherwise gain by the Mahakam Ale. He is able to put a chain together here, that being said, to get the outflow him once again.
Yeah, and of course, it's all up to Itchiko to catch up to this value, because of course, Itchiko takes the coin flip, which means that if you can smash enough tempo to get ahead and stay ahead, then you are in a very dominant position. Jgro is, of course, defending his position, playing for enough tempo to effectively box Itchiko out of that option.
100%. That's the name of the game here, and I like how you put it, defending his position. That's just a great way to put it. Couldn't have said it better myself.
Yeah. So it's Ichigo's turn here, and both players have very, very comparable options in terms of tempo. Ichigo is going to have to find value out of this muzzle at some point, and I think that's going to be his biggest challenge here, finding value out of the muzzle, finding value out of the Scorch. Those cards aren't great for this matchup. They are tech cards that are put in for other matchups, and when that happens, as a good player, you have to basically take whatever options you can for finding value.
I think you have to just be okay with the fact that a card like Muzzle is not going to be at its best here, and as soon as you can find what you would consider an acceptable or reasonable spot to get it down,
exactly,
get it down. Another interesting thing here is I'm looking at this Trial of the Grasses in Ichiko's hand. It might be very hard to stick a Witcher as a suitable target when your opponent has such great removal, right?
That's exactly right. It's going to be coming down to Ichiko what to do here, and there's not really great plays. Another thing about the Alchemy Mirror, of course, is that sometimes your Viper Witchers become extremely inconvenient to play. If you find yourself on the play in a difficult scenario, of course, if your opponent isn't ailing or if their ails are kind of hitting low-strength units at every opportunity, you're going to have to sacrifice some value on the Witchers. There's Ichiko playing the proactive ail. This enables the Witchers if Jgro wants to play them out however he wants to.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point there. Just being able to be the reactive player in this situation is worth so much. You're usually going to be able to eke out a little bit more points out of your cards than your opponent, and when you're all playing very similar cards, these small edges that you eke out incrementally over time really can add up.
It's a very, very reactive deck, especially so in the mirror matchup, of course. So here's Jgro playing the Kalvit into Slave Driver. He's going to be chaining a little bit harder. It's going to come down to what he finds from this. Finding the Vicovaro Novice, he has the opportunity for something like an ale. He swallows the Viper Witcher up to 13.
Yeah, that's interesting there. Swallow's not a card that you always see included, although I've been seeing a little bit more of it recently because Alchemy is a deck that has these stringent deck building requirements, and right now I sort of think 10 is the magic number that you want to get to. So sometimes you have to play cards that aren't necessarily 100% optimal in a vacuum just to hit that magic number of 10.
Yeah, exactly, and that's why we see a lot of different variations on Alchemy running. Pretty interesting Alchemy slots for their silvers and golds especially. You see stuff like Trial of the Grasses. You see stuff like Black Blood. Unfortunately, Dragro's Last Swallow will have enabled Ichiko's Viper Witcher for a full 15 points of value. He's going to swing the tables there, and as you've noticed, in this turn, he has swung it. Ichiko has gotten ahead of Jgro's score. This is imperatively important. This means that if Ichiko can stay ahead on every turn, he has the Trial of the Grasses as well. If he commits to this, if he stays ahead, he can box Jgro out.
I completely agree. Boxing him out is absolutely correct here. Once you've managed to pull ahead or turn the corner, however you want to phrase it,
yes.
Once you get there, basically, particularly in these mirror matches, you just have to match your opponent's play. If he plays a novice into an ale, you can play a novice into an ale, and you're still in the same situation, which was highly favorable. So if he can match on points, he no longer has that mountain to climb, and it's going to be a very favorable position going forward.
And that's one of Gwent's most important fundamentals. It's all about controlling speed, controlling
correct.
Tempo, and knowing when to abuse it. We're going to see the Cancerella here. This is going to put Jgro's score up to 60, and Ichiko will need to threaten a total of 26 to break this. What do you think about this play?
It's certainly an interesting time. I didn't see the Cantarella coming there. I was thinking maybe there was another 13 on the board, but it doesn't look like that's the case. I'm trying to figure out the line of play of what our player's trying to accomplish here. Maybe you're seeing something I'm missing, Swim?
No, I am not. Now, Jgro might be inclined to counter with his own Cantarella, but he's actually looking at a pretty solid pass here at the same time. It depends exactly how he wants to play this. There's no way Ichiko can make this up, even with some card he doesn't have in just one card, because, of course, he needs that 26 points here.
Yeah, I really like that pass here.
Yeah, that's a beautiful pass coming out from Jgro.
It seems very, very good. You put your opponent in this very awkward situation, and we know from seeing what was near the top of his deck from the Calvate before that this player has Trial of the Grasses and Scorch in their deck. So if they're forced in a situation where they don't get last say in a round, those two cards do not play very nicely with each other. So there could be some interesting interactions coming up.
And I'm getting some flashbacks into Marktheus versus Heat, the third game casted today. Silver Spy is being played round one versus round two. Of course, holding them onto round two gives you a lot more flexibility of options, as Ichiko has to make 26 points, and he will be expending two cards to do that.
Yeah, he's got to go for it here. Otherwise, he just gets Cantarella'd back into the Stone Age next round and gives away full control of the entire game to Jgro here. I think Jgro, by making that pass, which I think was very, very good for him, puts himself in a I'm okay with basically anything scenario here.
Yep. And there's the Trial of the Grasses expended as well, which is huge in this matchup. It will free him up a little bit for Scorch, which we know he is drawing into because we did see hit from the Calvit at the start. But he is one card down, and he has expended a large part of his win condition. There's the Vigilforce, but he still has a bit of an awkward muzzle here.
Yeah, the muzzle's a little bit awkward. I do really like that Trial of the Grasses play. As you were saying, now it doesn't interact negatively with the Scorch, but it's also, he knows that his Witchers might not be the easiest to keep alive in the mirror matchup when his opponent has Witchers to slam down and remove them. So I am a big fan of the line he took there.
There's the Dry Pass coming out from Ichiko, securing the last play effectively, unless, of course, the Cantarella is saved for round three, which it can be, in which case it gives you the last play. It gives you the reactivity in exchange for some amount of points. Here's Jgro. He's going to go ahead and use his Ointment. He has the res on whatever he wants, presumably just resing some non-committal card, Slave Driver, declining effectively any ability from any Ointment. There's the Vibe Butcher. This develops an additional one into the graveyard, and we go to round three. Six cards per player, and Jgro has the first play, Ichiko has the last play.
So we were talking about some round one spy things in this very game. What do you think about round three spy? Do you think he's holding on to the Cantarella, or do you think that's going back into the deck?
Well, it comes down to whether you would like to trade those points for reactivity. Reactivity is extremely important. In fact, in this matchup, it's even worth points, because if you look at Jager's hand, if he mulligans that spy, he only has the Stefan in terms of a proactive play. He keeps the Cantarella in hand. He has to go first. This is going to give him the proactivity that maybe he wants. He can even play the Cantarella after the Stefan to draw into its targets, although he doesn't need to do that because he has the Vilgefortz pulling out the Stefan target.
Yeah, I do like this here, and as you were saying earlier, sometimes the Viper Witchers don't get full value. The Cantarella having a big 13 strength body provides a nice solid target that you can just throw your Viper Witcher at, so I sort of like it here.
And there's the Stefan Skellen. If I were to guess, that would be the Aseer he just put on top of his deck, I think, because, of course, he still has the Roach that he needs to enable in that way.
Yes, he's also got to find the Kahir, though, right?
That's true.
I think that Kahir is probably the most important card here, but yeah, it's definitely strange. The Roach is an intricate part of this plan as well. I think we're going to be relying on Cantarella, if we're in Jgro's seat, to really put in a lot of work and sort of fix this hand and piece it together.
Yeah, and I actually like the call for keeping Cantarella in that case. Here we'll see whether he took the Aseer or the Kahir. It looks like it's the Kahir. Now, he probably has the Aseer off this. He'll have to find into it, but his odds are high, of course, and with that, he has the Roach off of the Vilgefortz as well.
Yeah, he's got that coming down after, which that does force you to sequence the Kahir first, though, right? Because theoretically, you could get an additional card deeper to look in if you Vilgefortz first and then Kahir.
And here's Ailed. Now this, however, at the same time, is going to be an uphill climb. Jgro has this big finisher combo, but he's 32 points behind and only one card up. That's going to be hard to make, and that's one of the downsides of keeping that Silver Spy for round three.
I completely agree. That is the downside to it.
Do you think this is a bridgeable gap?
I don't think it's unbridgeable. Whether it's, I don't know. I think he's probably a slight underdog from this position, but I think it's very, very close because the Kahir is just such raw power. Sometimes achieving close to 30 points if you have the it mandraked and everything.
Yeah, I think this will actually be a very close game. It looks like Ichiko might be favored. Here's the Kahir onto the Kalvite. Not snapping the Aseer immediately could mean that he didn't find it.
There's that, and there's also the fact that he wants to take care for the ordering of his cards because he knows the Vilgefortz is going to pull the next one. So maybe he has to make a certain play knowing that the Vilgefortz is going to pull the top card if the top card there was a little bit awkward for him.
Yep, so there is the Aseer putting back the Mandrake, and of course the 10-point Roach into his deck. As soon as he plays that Vilgefortz, he's getting the 10-point Roach out. Here's the Ointment from Ichiko onto the Slave Driver, presumably for some extra value, but he's taking the safer Novice instead. He has more reses to come. Here's the Ointment again. Here's the Novice again.
He has the Ointment.
Into the Slave Driver. If he wants it, he can chain more Slave Driver into Viper Witcher because he's out of alchemy cards, and this is going to slam Aseer for a good amount of points. Note, though, that Jgro did put the Mandrake back into his deck. He could be pulling it with Vilgefortz, and that's a huge heal on the Aseer there he just developed for himself.
That certainly is. And besides the potential of the heal, there's also, if more Mahakam Ales come down on Ichigo's side of the board, if he gets fortunate rolls for himself, Jgro can find himself hitting a unit for a large chunk of points.
Now, there's still a Scorch in Ichiko's deck, right?
I believe there is still a Scorch in his deck,
correct. If he pulls his own Scorch with Vilgefortz onto his own Cantarella, Joe, we may be looking at an utter disaster for Itchiko.
Yeah, that would not be good for him here.
Jgro is not giving him an out. He is not hitting that Cantarella. He is leaving it at that 17 points. There is really no way he can play around this. If he uses Vesemir before it, it thins and increases the likelihood further. And that is not a great roll off of Runestone with three bad options.
Yeah, that's not. And I think Jgro is intentionally leaving the Cantarella there, as you were saying. I think that's super important. Once you're playing against the deck for the second time, you start to learn a little bit about the deck, and you know exactly which cards you can and can't play around. What are we going with here? Cadaverine?
It doesn't look good. Of course, the Ox represents 7. Here's the Fringilla, but it's spying now. It looks like he chose it thinking it could be played loyally. It got changed, and he has to play it disloyally, losing a little bit of value compared, of course, to the Ox as well.
Yeah, it's always tough when cards go through such severe changes like that, and the fact that they sort of function in different ways. I don't think that this was the play he was intending to, and I think you can sort of see that on his face right now.
So here's Jgro's Vilgefortz. He could find the Mandrake, but he kills the Aesir, giving him no out for that. Here's the Roach, and he gets whatever he wants. Mandrake on the Cantarella. Wow.
Okay, that's interesting there.
This changes the board entirely.
It does completely change the board. That's probably the most raw points, and maybe he thinks that that's the angle he has to attack it from. This could potentially open up the Scorch off of Vilgefortz later in the round, though, as the Roach at 10 is currently the highest strength unit on the board.
And Jgro finds himself 11 up. If this Vilgefortz pulls the Roach, he could, or pulls the Scorch, he could be in for it. There's the Viper Witcher, even better. Huge swing potential for this. Jgro is only 3 points up before this Viper Witcher gets played. He has his own to counter with, and I think Itchiko will probably end up taking it, but it can completely depend on this Black Blood.
Yeah, I think this is going to come down to what the Black Blood has to offer here.
I mean, it's Black Blood versus Vesemir here. Jager's 2 points up, but Vesemir is a better option typically. We're going to have to see what it's pulling. Here's the Mandrake. He doesn't have amazing options. It's going to completely come down to this Black Blood.
What are we looking for off of Black Blood here? Alghul's probably pretty good here.
Azrael would be pretty good. We also have the Abaya on the Arrakis. Venom on the Range Draw is not bad. That is enough. We're going to see Itchiko effectively playing this for another 6. So what Jgro needs to develop is an 11 from Black Blood. And Ekimara would do it. A ghoul, or rather an Alzghul, would do it. Most things would do it here. It's very, very hard for him to not find this. Jgro should have it.
I'm excited.
There it is.
He picked that one pretty quickly.
There's the Azrael.
There's the Azrael.
13 points, and that will be enough. Jgro taking it 2-0 against Itchiko.